So we will continue our discussion on history in the session. Okay, so we have so far reached 1914 in our discussion of modern India, and we have reached till World War I. And this World War I, I'll be discussing as part of world history later, because this is part of your mains only. So it is not that great significant in your prelims. So let's continue from our Indian history side. But let's try to understand the impact of World War I on the Indian freedom struggle. So we have this Khadar Party and the militant nationalism during World War I, Home Rule League. Okay, all these are actually connected to the World War I. So we'll try to obviously understand the impact of, you know, World War One in the context of Indian freedom struggle. World War as such in detail, everything will be covering as part of your world history later. That's I'm keeping it for mains. So let me complete till 1947, and then we will go for post-independence India, and then we will go for world history. Okay, so in 1914, what is the significance? Actually, Tilak was released from jail. So if you remember, in 1907 there was a Surat split, and that was the split between moderates and extremists. And after that, the movement got weakened, and the moderate extremist leader Tilak was sent to jail, and then movement got weakened, and then there was the first phase of militant nationalism we have discussed. Now Tilak was released. Now at this point, there was actually a question in the minds of the nationalist whether you want to support the Indian troops' involvement in World War I. See, the World War is actually happening between, on one side it is German and the Ottoman Empire or the Turkish Empire, and on the other side it is the British, French, Russian, and later US also joined in 1917. So India have nothing to do with it, but majority of the army members are actually from India. More than 2 lakh of the English troops are from India. Okay, so the question in the minds of the nationalist at this time is whether they should support the Indian troops' involvement in the World War One, where we have nothing to do with the war. Indians have nothing to do with the war. Indians have no role to play, even though these troops or the army members are paid by the English only. And finally, that they have decided that Indians will support the English during this crisis that they are suffering during World War One. So we will support them with the expectation that after the war they will repay it back in terms of significant devolution of power. Okay, so this was the idea which was going on during this time among the nationalists. And if you see, Tilak was released in 1914, and Tilak and Annie Besant, together they tried for unification of Congress. So they wanted to join this moderates and extremists, because already the nationalist movement got weakened after the Surat split, and somehow they must be rejoined. So Tilak have made number of assurances that Tilak said he won't go for any mass movement or mass mobilization to overthrow British, and he said he will only demand for self-rule similar to the white colonies, or the home rule as part of Home Rule League movement, as similar to the white colonies, and there won't be any mass movement to overthrow British. If at all it is there, it is clear for Tilak that the moderate leaders will not allow this or accept it. Okay, so he promised, or he gave number of assurances, and at the same time moderates were also in a position to accept them, because they have already realized that there was nothing happened during this time, 1907 Surat split to, or 1909 Indian Council Act to 1914, nothing is actually happening. The nationalist movement actually got weakened, and the Britishers, if you remember, in 1907 Surat split, at that time I have told you, just before the Congress session, British actually met the moderate leaders and gave them assurances that they will go for significant devolution of power after the Congress session. And then 1909 Indian Council Act was passed, which was known as Morley-Minto reform. Okay, and one of the demand of nationalists was Indians to be in majority in the Legislative Council, and one of the provision in that, Indians were in majority for the first time in Legislative Council. But moderate leaders were unhappy with that, because their demand was not just Indians to be in majority, but elected Indians to be in majority. See, the condition is like, let's suppose 100 members are there in total, Indians are in majority, that means out of this maybe 60 Indians will be there, and rest 40 others will be there. Okay, now out of the 60, there will be some elected as well as nominated. So out of this, let's say 40 elected and 20 nominated are there. This 20 nominated will be always loyal to the British, and these two will be always supporting the British, and the elected Indians are still in minority. So elected Indians, as they are still in minority, they could not take any decisions. So the major demand is the elected Indians to be in majority in Legislative Council, and that is what we are going to see in the next reform in 1919 Government of India Act. So here they were actually unhappy with this 1909 Indian Council Act, and finally they have decided to join hands together. So Congress, all the moderates and extremists, join hands in 1914 with the support or with the efforts of Annie Besant and Tilak. Okay, now we need to discuss about Home Rule League movement. Okay, it was started by Tilak and Annie Besant. She was an Irish lady, so it was similar to the Irish Home Rule League. Okay, so Home Rule League movement was started. Basically, the objective is to create political consciousness amongst the masses. And with that, you can actually exert pressure on the English, and with the expectation that later there will be significant devolution of powers and we can establish a home rule like other white colonies under the British. So effectively, they are demanding the self-rule. And related to Indian troops involvement in the World War I, they have also taken the nationalist stand that they have decided that they will support the Indian troops involvement in the World War I. So they are supporting the British in this crisis with the expectation that the British will repay it back in terms of significant devolution of power. And in Maharashtra, it was actually Tilak who led the movement, and except in Maharashtra, entire India, it was Annie Besant who led this movement. Okay, and the strategies that they have adopted is actually the plays, street plays, okay, and speeches in libraries. All these were their strategy. So it's all about spreading political consciousness among the minds of the people or the public. Now, one very important thing is you need to know the difference between Home Rule League and Khadar Party. So during this time, one more movement was going on which is related to Khadar Party. So as I have discussed about militant nationalism during World War II, that was in fact the second phase of militant nationalism. The first phase of militant nationalism was between 1908 to 1911, which is connected to the partition of Bengal. So the second phase of militant nationalism is connected to World War II. So during this time, Lala Hardayal, Barkatullah Khan, and they all have decided to organize a party, and they have formed this Khadar Party in San Francisco, which was in US. I've told you already, US was not part of this war in the beginning. So this organization was actually formed openly and formally, and their objective was to, they have seen this as a great opportunity because most of the Indian troops were in English army and they were abroad. So military control in India is actually weak, and they have decided that, or they have understood, or they have thought that if we can instigate a mutiny among the Indian soldiers at this time, it is very easy to militarily overthrow English. Okay, so they have tried to instigate a mutiny. That was their objective. During this time, one incident, Komagata Maru incident, 1914, which can be asked as a prelims question, which was related to Continuous Passage Act, 1914. What was this Continuous Passage Act? It was actually an anti-immigration policy which was taken by the Canadian government under the pressure of British government. There were two conditions under Continuous Passage Act. The first one is you cannot be a legal migrant in Canada unless you satisfy two conditions. The first condition is you should travel from the origin to destination in a single uninterrupted journey. That means you cannot stop in between. See, normally from Asia, if you travel, you take around 60 days and you used to stop at Europe. So it is basically to discriminate the Asians or the non-whites. Secondly, you should have an adequate financial balance if you need to be a legal migrant in Canada. So this was Continuous Passage Act, and it was clearly an anti-immigration policy, and it was completely biased against the Asians. So it was the objective of Canadian government is basically to prevent Asians to enter into Canada. And 320 Indians, okay, the potential migrants to Canada, they started from Hong Kong and they went to Vancouver port by satisfying the condition, and in 55 days in an uninterrupted journey, they have reached the Canadian port, and they were not allowed to enter there by saying that the reason was they have not satisfied the second condition, even though they have come in an uninterrupted journey, but they didn't had enough or adequate financial balance, and they were forced to send back or come back to Calcutta. When they reached Calcutta, they have requested the British government to talk to Canadian government regarding this issue to support them. And in police firing, around 22 people died, and this is what all about Kamagata Maru incident. But this was actually highlighted that the British government is not at all interested in the issues of Indians, and Khadar party tried to capitalize on the sentiment which was there in Punjab at that time, and they tried to instigate mutiny among the army members who were stationed in Punjab. But the news was somehow leaked to the English, and they have passed an act, Defense of India Act 1915, and through that they were able to imprison many potential army members who were supposed to participate in mutiny, and later on they were hanged also. And by this time later, US also joined in the World War One. So there was a crackdown of this Khadar party. Okay, so Lala Hardayal somehow managed to escape, and he went to Germany, and there he met Mr. Zimmermann, who was a foreign secretary of the German. Okay, and Zimmermann offered financial assistance to Lala Hardayal and Khadar party to instigate a mutiny among the Indian soldiers in the British army, so that you can weaken the British army so that German can win the war. Okay, so this was all about Zimmermann plan. So what I want to tell you is Home Rule League is going on one side and Khadar party on the other side, which was parallelly going during World War One. Their objectives are entirely different. Khadar party want to militarily overthrow British by instigating a mutiny, but here Home Rule League actually supporting the English during the time of war, and with the expectation that there will be a self-rule later and there will be a significant devolution of power on the line similar to white colonies. Okay, so let me write it down, the important points here. Home Rule League. Okay, so as per Bibin Chandra, there is a very famous statement by Bibin Chandra, and you can actually use this in your mains answer. Home Rule League movement is actually a less charged but a more effective response to the Indian troops involvement in World War One as compared to Khadar party Home Rule League was a less charged but more effective response to the involvement of Indian troops in World War One. Okay, they supported the involvement of Indians, involvement of Indian troops in World War One, but argued that the loyalty of Indians must be repaid as soon as the war comes to an end. Okay, so now we are showing the loyalty, but it must be repaid. How? By a significant devolution of power to establish a self-rule, as its name indicate, or home rule under British. See, it is very difficult to read, I know, because see, when I'm writing it in this iPad, it will be like this only. You cannot write it the way you write in the book. I've seen some comments that you are writing so dirty and it is very difficult to read. That's why I'm reading it. Okay, so I'm reading it, and then I'm writing, so it will be easy for you to take down notes if your ultimate objective is to take down notes. Now, what are the strategies? See, the strategy is all about, you know, mobilize political consciousness among the minds of Indians, and they have used state plays, okay, the speeches in libraries, etc. Okay, so strategy to mobilize nationalist consciousness amongst the Indian masses, and how plays, public meetings, speeches in libraries, okay, and it will actually educate Indians in the involvement of Indian troops in the World War One. Now, I want to discuss clearly about the difference between, you know, Khadar movement and this Home Rule League movement, because this is very much important. Many students have the confusion, and this is going to help you in a very good way in your prelims. Okay, so you need to have a very good comparative understanding about Home Rule League and Khadar Party. See, Home Rule League, first and most important point, it was a mass movement. You are trying to mobilize political consciousness amongst the masses and participation of masses there. On the other hand, Khadar Party, it's not a mass movement organized by some people in US, and they wanted to instigate mutiny among the Indian soldiers, and they were failures. All that was a failure also, because the immediate objective of instigating a mutiny could not be realized. So here, no force, no use of force. Here there is use of force. Okay, now here they supported English in World War One. Here they did not support, and not only supported, rather they tried to instigate mutiny, and they have taken it as an opportunity to militarily overthrow English. Okay, and here demanded devolution of power. On the other side, there is no such demand. They need complete independence, so they want British to be thrown back. Okay, so they want militarily overthrow Britishers. So this is a clear-cut difference between Home Rule and the Khadar. Okay, now we will quickly discuss about the importance of or the significance of Home Rule League. So significance, this was the biggest mass movement organized till now. After partition of Bengal, this was the biggest mass movement organized till now after partition of Bengal. Okay, so there was movements after partition of Bengal, mass movements. So after that, this was the biggest. It did bring political consciousness to areas which had still not awakened by nationalist consciousness. That means I'm talking about politically very backward regions. Okay, so the movement was able to manage a very good mass base. And I've already told you Bibin Chandra's statement, it was a less charged but more effective response to the World War One related to Indian troops involvement. Less charged but more effective response to involvement of Indians in World War One.